1951 United Kingdom General Election, Wikipedia article audio. Clement Attlee, Labour. Winston Churchill, Conservative. The 1951 United Kingdom general election was held 20 months after the 1950 general election, which the Labour Party had won with a slim majority of just 5 seats. The Labour government called a snap election for Thursday, October 25, 1951, hoping to increase their parliamentary majority. However, despite winning the popular vote and achieving both their highest ever total vote and percentage vote share, Labour were defeated by the Conservative Party. This election marked the beginning of the Labour Party's 13-year spell in opposition, and the return of Winston Churchill as Prime Minister. This was the final general election to be held with George VI as monarch, as he died the following year on February 6 and was succeeded by his daughter, Elizabeth II. The 1951 general election was the second general election to be covered on BBC television. On election night, the results were televised from the BBC Lime Grove studios in London. Graham Hutton, David Butler and H.G. Nicholas headed the election night coverage from 10:15 p.m. until 4:00 a.m. on the television service. On the following day, television coverage started at 10:00 a.m. and continued throughout the day until 5:00 p.m. Clement Attlee had decided to call the election because of the King's concerns that, when leaving the country to go on his Commonwealth tour in 1952 with a government that had such a slim majority, there would be a possibility of a change of government in his absence. The Labour government, which by now had implemented most of its 1945 election manifesto, was beginning to lose cabinet ministers, such as Ernest Bevin and Stafford Cripps, due to old age. The Conservatives, however, after the previous year's election, appeared fresher, with more new MPs. Labour's manifesto stated that the party, proud of its record, sure in its policies, confidently asks the electors to renew its mandate. It identified 4 key tasks facing the United Kingdom which it would tackle: the need to work for peace, the need to work to maintain full employment and to increase production, the need to reduce cost of living, and the need to build a just society. The manifesto argued that only a Labour government could achieve these tasks. It also contrasted the Britain of 1951 with that of the interwar years, saying this period saw mass unemployment, mass fear, mass misery. While Labour began to have some policy divisions during the election campaign, the Conservatives ran an efficient campaign that was well-funded and orchestrated. Their manifesto, Britain Strong and Free, stressed that safeguarding our traditional way of life was integral to the Conservative purpose. Significantly, they did not propose to dismantle the welfare state or the National Health Service which the Labour government had established. The manifesto did, however, promise to stop all further nationalisation and to repeal the Steel Act introduced by the Labour government. As for the Liberals, the poor election results in 1950 only worsened. Unable to get the same insurance against losses of deposits that they did the previous year, they were able to field only 109 candidates, and thus posted the worst general election result in the party's history, getting just 25% of the vote and winning only 6 seats. Their popular vote total has not fallen so low since, though their lowest total of 6 seats would be matched in several future elections. 4 candidates were returned unopposed, all in Northern Ireland. This was the last general election in which any candidates were returned unopposed, although there have since been unopposed by-elections. The subsequent Labour defeat was significant for several reasons. The party polled almost 250,000 votes more than the Conservatives and their National Liberal allies combined, won the most votes that Labour has ever won, and won the most votes of any political party in any election in British political history, a record not surpassed until the Conservative Party's victory in 1992. Despite this, it was the Conservatives who formed the next government with a majority of 17 seats. Under the first-past-the-post electoral system, many Labour votes were wasted as part of large majorities for MPs in safe seats. Additionally, most of Labour's overall popular vote margin can be accounted for as being the votes not polled by the Conservatives' Ulster Unionist allies in the 4 constituencies in which they were unopposed. The UUP would poll 166,400 votes in these 4 constituencies 4 years later. This was the 4th of 5 elections in the 20th century where a party lost a popular vote, but won the most seats. The others were January 1910, December 1910, 1929 and February 1974, it also happened in the 1874 election. Furthermore, the 1951 and 1874 elections are the only two examples of a political force winning an overall majority while losing the popular vote. The National Liberals were in alliance with the Conservatives, bringing total conservative strength to 321 seats, votes total 13,717,850. All comparisons are with the 1950 election.